when I came to, I remember going up in the air. I don't remember coming down. When I came to, you know, the only thing I could move was my right arm. I thought, what am I doing here? The other guys were pieces, you know. I'm Peter Athans. I was born in Canton, Ohio, February 11th, 1924. Joined the Marine Corps in 1942. I'm a World War II veteran.
Hercules is where you met some Marines.
Right. They were in the transport department. And that's where Walt was.
Colonel Walt?
Yeah. He was there. And I met the guy, I forget his name, a red-headed guy. And I wound up in the same company with him.
And that's why you chose the Marine Corps when you enlisted?
Probably. Yeah, probably. Influenced me.
Where did you first see combat?
A little bit in New Guinea.
Okay.
Then Cape Gloucester, and that island there, you know, we took the bottom half, the southern half, up to a place where they called Tapasea, the river, and you know, the Japs had the biggest, one of the biggest naval bases in the northern part, Rabaul. And they had over 100,000 troops up there, but they didn't know we were only one division. They never crossed the line. And if they'd have known, they'd have wiped us out.
When you were going to reinforce George Company?
Three of us.
Yeah, the
we're
three
taking them ammunition, machine gun, and a mortar. And
yeah, could you tell us how that started, where the lieutenant said you needed three men?
Yeah. Needed three men. He says, get me three men. So I looked at my guys, and you know, that was, we were already in combat for almost 4 months, and we were out. And I looked and I found the two healthiest guys, and I told them, come with me. We got a machine gun, a mortar, and all the ammunition we could carry. Boy, we were loaded down, probably 100 pounds each. And so the Japs had the top, the side of the hills, and we had the top. They were in caves and that. Now, they didn't have no heavy weapons, machine gun fire, rifle fire from them caves. So at the end of the peninsula, we had to go across a sand, a stretch of sand, right by the ocean. So I told the guys, I told them, listen, they're going to be firing at us, and they're up high. We're going to look about this big to them. I said, zig and zag and don't take no chances. If you see bullets hitting in front of you, hit it, fight a different way. Go backwards part of the way. They look for you to go forward. So all the way across we made it. And then there was a hut there, grass hut. And we figured we'd have to infiltrate it. Maybe there was Japs in there. So we got ready, we infiltrated it. There was nobody there. And inside the door there was boxes. So we wondered what's in them boxes, you know. So I always carried a thin rope with me, a long one. So we tied it to the lid, got out, pulled it open. Nothing happened. Got up there and it was saggy. So I told the guys, on the way back, we'll take a bottle. Each take a bottle. So now we commence to go up along the ocean. George Company noted that, was told by our company that we made it across. So they sent a squad over to help us because we had a lot of weight. And boy, it's sad, you know, when you're carrying 100 pounds, you sink down, you can't run fast. And so we get there, and they had a regular officer in that George Company. He was an old timer, you know, he knew what he was doing. So they were in worse shape than my company. I says to him, well, I'll call this lieutenant and tell him we'll stay here and help you. So got him on the radio, called him, He says, I run the company. He says, you get your ass back here and right now, leave. I told him we were lucky to get across there. He says, I'm telling you, you're leaving right now. This officer couldn't believe it. That guy told us that. So we went back, infiltrated that hut again, make sure nobody got in there. And I put one in my pack now, I'm going back empty. And it's a quart. And the one guy, Jones, he put one in his pack. The other guy put three in his pack. That's where I made a mistake. Then he put between his fingers, he slung his rifle, and put between his fingers, he's going to carry him. I told him, your life is more valuable than that. But I made a mistake. I should have told him to drop him. That was the one time I didn't give the right command. I didn't do the right thing. Now we started across, and we're going, and infiltrating, you know, taking turns. And when you see bullets hitting in front of you, you hit it and go a different direction, crawl, you know, creep. And I look back, and this guy's coming, and I see the machine gun, hit bullets in front of him, and I hollered at him, hit it, hit it. He won't hit it. And boy, he got him right through here, and it came out through here, right through his lungs and that. And the bottles went up in the air. So me and Jones dug a trench in the sand, going back to him, pulled him into a shell hole, stuffed the holes with part of his jacket, you know. What could we do? I says to Jones, I says, you stay here. Our company can protect you from up there. I'm going to go find some help to get him out of here. So I went the back way. They know I'm going to the left. I went to the right. And I start zigging. We never had no tanks until then. I saw a tank right at the end of that there last hill. And this lieutenant was sticking out of the tank, you know. I jumped on the tank. I told him, I got a man out there. Let's go get him. He's wounded. He says, who are you? I said, Sergeant Athans. He says, this tank doesn't move without orders, is what he said. So I had my Thompson slung. Pulled out the 45, put it between his eyes. I says, you just got the orders. And the tank moved. So we got there and the guy died. So we put his body on the tank and walked on the other side from the hill. And get back, he asked me again, you know, when we got there, he says, what outfit you in? I told him, Fox Company, 2nd Battalion, 5th Marines. When we got back to the area, radio call from one of the battalion CP. So I get there, and that's Lieutenant Colonel Wall, my buddy. He says, Pete, here's what I heard. I says, you heard it right. He says, would you have killed him? I says, absolutely, if he didn't move. He says, I'd have done the same thing.
How did you pass the time when you were like in the Russells and you were kind of in this quiet, out of the...
Well, a lot of training. We always got the replacements, you know, and we're training. And then we did steal a movie projector from the Navy and one film, King's Row. And every night, built a screen and that, you know, painted it silver and that, and cut the logs down, and you sat on logs, you know, on a hill. I don't care. We saw that movie 100 times in 100 days. After the training was over, everybody was there to see the movie. But you knew it. But you kept going, even if it rained. Play it. You could hardly see the screen, right? It was something to do.
So you remember the first time that you come in contact with a Japanese soldier or Marine?
Yeah. Going through the jungle. I was the rear guard. It was a battalion. We were cutting through the jungle, and it was thick, you know. And I was the rear guard, the last guy. And so all of a sudden, this Jap come out of the underbrush, and he had, you know, they had them long rifles. Before he could lower the rifle down, I hit him with a machine gun. Now that's the guy that I never forgot his face. All the other ones, you know, it's long range and that. You don't know if you hit them or somebody else hit them. But That's the only one that I remember distinctly, that I remember his face. And then during that episode, when we were gone, this Marine was laying against a tree, and he's sitting on his helmet. And I went over to him, and my sister, I looked at him, I said, "What's wrong?" He couldn't talk. And he was breathing like he had asthma. I thought, geez, how'd he get in the Marine Corps if he's got asthma, you know? And I looked at him, he wasn't shot or anything. So I got the guy in front of me, I says, "Get the word out, get a corpsman back here." So this corpsman came, I told him, "What's wrong with this guy?" He went over and checked him. He's got a jumbo rod. A jumbo rod, yeah. He's got it in the lungs. I said, "What are you going to do for him?" He said, "Nothing I can do." He says, "I'm going to give him a shot of morphine." And he said, "He'll be dead in no time." The word shocked me, you know. That's when I learned about jumbo rod. So I says to him, "Tell him that I'm going to stay back here with him." And he passed the word up. Corbin left, and I was back here with him, and, you know, and he acted like he wanted to smoke, you know. So I pulled out a cigarette and lit it and gave it to him. He did get it up to his mouth. He took one drag, and then he held it out here, and then all of a sudden the cigarette rolled off his fingers right into the mud, you know, and it's raining. And then his hand fell, and then he fell over. Fell off the helmet. I thought, I wonder if this guy's dead. What do I know about medicine, right? So I started checking him. And in the jungles there, you know, a body started swelling right away. You could see features changing. I said, "He is dead." He wasn't breathing. I couldn't find a pulse. So I pulled him in the underbrush, got the map out, marked where it was, about, you know, where it was. And then when our column caught up where we were going, I went ahead of our company and kept asking if this guy was there. I took one of his dog tags. And finally, I found the company that he belonged to. So I give it to them. He was the sergeant, but he said, "I'll give it to the lieutenant." And I told him, marked it on his map, where it was. And, you know, and in general, after the place is cleared, you know, and it's over, like in the Milans, there's a grave registrar comes in and finds the bodies. They're either buried or where they were hit, you know, and they couldn't get them out. And that's where they find them. You're looking for them. You know. So then, in that campaign, that must have been, that was in Cape Gloucester. And it wasn't long, I got jungle rot. I went to change my socks, you know. I came to a stream, it wasn't changing. I was going to go in there and wash. I took my leggings off, my shoes off, and when I went to take the socks off, my skin came off. I had Jesus Christ. And then I could see my foot swelling. And you know, we had them high tops up to here. I couldn't get my shoe on. So I cut the back end off, you know, in the back, so I can get in there, tied it as tight as I could, put the leggings on before my foot swelled. So I thought, well, I'll just wash with my clothes on, you know, what did you have? Just trousers and jacket. Got in that stream, washed. You know, a lot of times we didn't wash for 2 or 3 weeks. We had no way of getting, you know, washed up or shave or anything. Then I knew I had jungle rot.
Did you know what was going on in Europe? Did you know what was going on?
Well, my father sent me the camp repository, but then I'd be gone for 4 months in campaign, you know, combat, and then we'd get to this, like, the Russells, where we had our tent, and it'd be stacked up, and I could read the papers. Yeah, I'd know what's going on in Europe.
So, you're... communications as far as with other people at home, your father, your mother, your brothers, whatever, that was all through the mail, of course. And
V-mail.
V-mail.
You were only allowed to write this much. And they put it in film. And they could put 1,000 letters in a little film, you know, and then develop it when it gets back. Yeah.
right before you got wounded, what were you doing?
We're setting up a OP in front of our line.
Yeah.
And it was about...
And this was on which island?
Okinawa.
Okinawa, okay.
And I told the guys, well, spread out 25 yards apart and we'll converge on that hill where we're going to set the OP up. And that's where halfway across the machine gun opened up on the right side. And I got hit. That officer from the Navy, from a heavy cruiser, he was going to give us 14 and 16 inch shells. He got hit in the knees. And the third guy over got hit in the ankles. And the other four guys were safe. The hill protected them. But in a moment, we were all gone from the left side. But we didn't know. Now we get there, and I told them, dig in because they know why we're here. Can't dig in, it's all rock. Built rocks around yourself. I said, get rocks and build a little parapet around yourself. And there was a rock almost as big as that window in the front. And I go to see what's in front of us. About a mile in front of us, it was a valley. And it ran parallel to our line. And that's where they'd come from. And when they'd come, they'd come in force. And we didn't see them until they got past that hill. It was too late. We didn't have enough guys left, you know, and we're thin. So what happened is they knew what we were doing, and they threw a shell in there. We got zeroed in on them two draws with the Navy and artillery and everybody. And then a shell came in from the Jap side. The first one hit way behind me, but the concussion pushed me against this rock. I'm the only guy standing. And as I went to get up, the second one came in and hit me. Half of the shell hit me, and then I was up in the air, and a lot of shells come in there. They got us. And then the other guys were dead, they were in pieces. When I did come to, I guess the Japs already counterattacked and left. I came to, the only thing I could move was my right arm. So I thought, what am I doing here? I better get back to the line. So I reached behind me, grabbed rock, grass, whatever I could, drag myself. And I could see the shape I was in. And I thought I got back, and I never got back. It was this corpsman that found me. He thought I was dead. When he turned me over, he says, your eyes rolled up and looked at me. And see, earlier in that day, this officer we had left, he says, we got two new corpsmen, and he mentioned names. One was German and one was Spanish. And when I looked at him, he was fair-complected, blue-eyed, blonde. I says, Bob Kessler? And he nodded yes. He says, then you went into a coma. He says, we have no way to get you out. Everything was already 7 miles away, you know, to the hospital. He says, so I stopped the tank, put you on a tank and got you there. And then when I got there, they declared me dead and put me with the dead guys. Yeah, and then at night, I could see the stars when I came to, you know, my mind, but I couldn't move. And I thought, where the hell am I? And pretty soon I heard voices and I saw a flashlight, peripheral vision I saw from the right. And it got closer and closer, and pretty soon I heard the voices. I thought, geez, that's the bearing detail. I better let them know I'm alive. I tried to move, I couldn't do nothing. When he got to me, evidently the guy squatted down by me. I still saw the stars, and he says, hey, Doc, this guy's still warm. And I thought, at least they know I'm alive. There's different ways, you know, the service during the war can ruin you. You get killed, you get wounded, or you lose the time.